Everyone has a game they hold close to their heart, a game that inspired them to become something or do something in life. Maybe for you it was a small blonde boy wielding a sword, or perhaps a theoretical physicist wielding a crowbar. But for me, it was a pig firing a bazooka. I was and still am obsessed with Hogs of War. Every week of my younger days were filled with the repetition of completing the single player campaign over and over again, or creating multiplayer games by myself and simply messing around with the pigs and weapons. In 2019, I met Jacob Hadgood in Sheffield, where I must have asked him a million questions about the game, before then proceeding to beat him in a quick skirmish match. So what's this all about then? Well, last year Hogs of War turned 20 years old, and I'm not a kid growing up in Birmingham anymore. I'm also not the kind of person who goes around making documentaries, but I've been wanting to shine a light on this game for quite some time and talk about its creators and give the full story of Hogs of War's development. From the history of the companies involved in Hogs' development to the individuals who put it all together, not to mention the ever-growing community that still exists today. I reached out to a bunch of the original development team. Some responded, some didn't, some weren't really able to remember much from a project that started almost 25 years ago. Hogs of War was one of the final legacies of a company that no longer exists, a bygone era that seems so long ago, yet also feels as if it was just yesterday. Yet that legacy left such a big impression that its effects can still be felt today, through the design of an up-and-coming remaster, the creation of countless mods, the eruption of esports, and the passion of a fandom that continues on into the present day. We're going to be diving headfirst into the full scope of this project, talking to its developers, fans, creators, and for the first time, uncovering some never-seen-before content for the failed sequel, Hogs of War 2. I know there'll be many people out there that'll be thinking that Hogs of War is such a niche game, why focus so much time and energy onto it? And in a way, you'd be right. Hogs was my first introduction into video games, and in my 26 years on this earth, it has continued to shape my own path through life and into the games industry. So, 20 years after the game's development, it's once again time to grab your helmets and take cover.
The Purple Army are on the attack again!
The business was growing and we were on a roll at that point. Massively exciting times in the video game industry.
You know, they were willing to invest money in marketing, and you know, that's how we led on to getting Rick Mail involved.
The nostalgia, the gameplay, which is still fresh, the game was very ahead of its time. And of course the great audio compartment, which still holds today despite the fact that the stereotypes are very marked.
There's definitely pressure on them, so pressure from the fans, but I think that's for every new game. If you make it, there's a pressure, of course.
The Mark 13 multi-wing fighter. Oh, what a secret. Perhaps you need to nail the fact that it's a little more obvious. Oh, what a secret.
The 1980s were the golden years for Gremlin Graphics Software, having been formed in Sheffield in 1984 by Ian Stewart and Kevin Norburn after the success of their computer game shop, Just Micro, a year previous. Perhaps their biggest success of that decade came in the form of Monty Mole, a game that lended itself to the miners' strikes that were occurring across the country at that time. Created by programmer Peter Harrop, it had the player control Monty as he headed deeper into a coal mine in order to collect coal and keep his family warm during the cold winter months. It was very much a game of its time, though.
Finally, the latest thing in computer games It may be politically biased, but it is highly topical. The villain of the piece, a miner called Arthur Scargill. The hero, Monty Mole, has to get his coal for the winter and run a gauntlet of flying pickets and cans of hairspray. Monty wins using a ballot paper. The game's 19-year-old inventor is the son of a mine safety officer. He says, as far as he knows, Mr. Scargill has not yet played the game.
You're writing on a 48K machine using tools that are on that same 48K machine, so you have to write it in parts. And then you have to combine all those parts together to test it. So it was quite challenging. And to be able to do all that and still turn out a game in 3 months, you know, it's unheard of these days. So it was very, very challenging, but very rewarding at the end of the day. At no point did I think that it was going to be as popular a character or as popular a game as it turned out to be.
So at that time, I actually sold my house. Downgraded and raised some money to open my own computer shop. Well, basically it was a computer shop mainly selling software, and that was called Just Micro in Sheffield, which was on Carver Street. So that was opened in 1983, and in a very short time I began to realise that there were bigger opportunities than just selling software. That's not to say that Just Micro wasn't successful. It was very successful. And if you talk to anybody in their sort of 30s around Sheffield, they probably spent time in there when they should have been at school. It was in those early days where I was exposed to a lot of the young kids and students around Sheffield who used to come into the shop, and they put their demos on the machines, because you always let people use the machines. And we started chatting to various kids and talking about what their aspirations were, etc. And we identified a few individuals that we could possibly look to employ and start developing our own product.
As the decade pushed over into the 90s, Gremlins enjoyed early success with the likes of Zool and the Premier Manager series. In 1994, the company would change its name to Gremlin Interactive, now focusing more on the ever-growing 16-bit console and PC market.
And everything really started from that point. Once we got a few employees going, Tony Crowther came on board, and the company built over the years then. It was about 1986 when that business got involved with a gentleman called Jeff Brown, who owned a company called Centresoft down in Tipton, near Birmingham. And I was using Centresoft as a distribution company. They'd obviously got the US Gold label at that time as well. And Jeff bought into the business, and we actually became part of the Centregold group at that point. Started opening new offices. We had offices in Lincoln, Derby, which ended up being the core design office, Sheffield, Birmingham. So the business was growing, and we were on a roll at that point. Massively exciting times in the video game industry.
With that shift, they produced their first Actua Sports Series game, Actua Soccer, in 1995. This series would continue right up to the new millennia, with Actua Golf in 1996, Actua Soccer 2 in 1997, Actua Golf 2, Actua Ice Hockey, Actua Tennis, and Actua Soccer 3 in 1998, and closing off with Actua Pool, Actua Ice Hockey 2, and Actua Golf 3 in 1999. Back in 95 though, Gremlin had a reported revenue of £10 million, which they quoted as saying, is growing all the time. A year later, and the company had acquired the renowned Scottish development studio DMA Design, who previously had created the Lemmings games and, more interestingly, the start of the Grand Theft Auto franchise. Sadly, the acquisition didn't include the rights to GTA, as DMA had already signed those over to the German conglomerate Bertelsmann before the takeover.
Well, Gremlin at that time, it'd gone through a few changes, and it was being managed at that time by Jenny Richards, Stuart and myself. And we were looking at ways of building the company up, and our idea was to take it public. And we needed to grow it fairly quickly, and we were looking for acquisitions, basically. We got to know Dave Jones, super guy, super talented, and a great team up in Dundee. Really, really creative team. And they'd been working on the original, what's that, that game they tell you, I think it had a minor success, Grand Theft something.
Yeah, I may have heard of that one, GTA or something.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Well, obviously, that was going to be my next question. It's like, you know, did you know about Grand Theft Auto when you bought them, and how come you let it get away?
Well, it was being developed for actually initially for Bertelsmann, and we had no say in it. They had a contract to produce. They'd sold the title to Bertelsmann, basically, and then subsequently Bertelsmann then sold it to Take-Two. So I'm afraid I nearly got my sticky fingers on it, but not quite.
At the same time, Gremlin were looking to float their company on the London Stock Exchange, but little did they know at that time that this would be a much harder task than they initially thought. At this point, though, Gremlin Interactive had their fingers in a lot of different pies. They were leading an industry, having produced games for PowerPC, Sega, Sony, and Windows. Everything was at an all-time high. The perfect time, it seemed, to begin work on a brand new title then. There would be two key figures who would proceed to head up the development of Hogs of War, the senior designer, Aid Carlos, and lead programmer, Jacob Habgood. Carlos had been hired by Gremlin back in 1991, while Habgood at the time was fairly new to the scene, having been hired in 1996. He'd had a junior programmer role during that time, working with Carlos on the game Reloaded, a science fiction top-down shooter that was released on PlayStation and MS-DOS.
And, you know, it was games like Zool, Monty Mole, I suppose, that had made me aware of Gremlin and made me want to come and work for them when I graduated in, 1996? Yeah, so I joined Gremlin Interactive in 1996, so they were still called Gremlin at that stage. Loaded had just been released as a release title on the PlayStation 1, so as an undergraduate, I had a PlayStation 1, and I was, you know, playing Loaded and thinking this was a really cool game, and I'd very much like to go and work for Gremlin, and I applied to work there, and you know, was over the moon to get my first job there working in Sheffield in Carver Street. My first title that I worked on was actually a game called Reloaded, which was the sequel to Loaded, but not nearly as good.
And you worked on Judge Dredd as well.
Yeah, Judge Dredd. I worked on a whole load of different games at Gremlin, but largely I had the pleasure of writing the memory card systems, which is a pretty dull thing to do. So I wrote all of the memory card systems for a whole range of different games on the PlayStation 1, but it was Reloaded that was my sort of first. I was a front-end programmer on Reloaded, and then Hogs of War was my first sort of lead project.
1 year later, after the production of Reloaded, Aid Carlos would create the first design document for Hogs of War. The initial concept was a lot more ambitious than its final form, as the plan listed extra details like landscape deformation, grappling hooks, and special abilities, to name just a few.
Well, how did the idea of pigs come around? Pigs of War, like Black Sabbath?
No, I think Aid Carlos, the designer, probably, you know, was more into that kind of thing. The story goes, and I have to sort of say that Ian Stewart does dispute this. So Ian Stewart, the guy who set up Gremlin, the story goes that Ian Stewart went to see Babe, and in a marketing meeting after having seen Babe, he said, well, you know, we really need to be making games about pigs. People like pigs. So, you know, they were looking at what games were doing well in the charts in those days. And it was actually Command & Conquer, not Worms, that inspired Hogs of War. So the original concept, that we had a two-page document written by Aid Carlos, who was the designer on Zool as well. It sort of sets out this idea for a game which is basically Command & Conquer with pigs.
The team's main set of artists, Ricky Martin, John Goering, John Taylor and Martin Rotherham, began coming up with several concepts for classes, including some in-game mock-ups later on down the line in 1998. It seemed the company began its development of Hogs of War using the standard practices it had developed over the past decade. However, in hindsight, that wasn't necessarily the best path to follow.
The behind every game is a huge team of people and years of preparation. But what do all these games have in common? Well, they were produced by one software company, Gremlin Interactive. We went behind the scenes at their headquarters to find out exactly what goes into making a new game and where the initial ideas come from.
The design for a game can come from one of many things, a character or a 3D engine. It really depends on the style of game. We like to start, a good story is a good starting point for a game.
So let's take Realms of the Haunting as an example. Following the brainstorming, the graphic designer gets to work producing a storyboard, like this one for the opening sequence. It's just like producing a movie, as every part of the game has a visual script. Meanwhile, the programmers are hard at work writing the game code and working on the engine, which provides the structure and movement within the game. The look of the game is crucial, and there's a whole team of people who design the graphics. They work either from drawings or from written descriptions of the characters and surroundings to create the final animated results. Everything from the backgrounds to smaller incidental objects need to be created, and it means a long, laborious process of modeling, coloring, and animating before they're ready to be part of the game. To give a more realistic feel to their games, Gremlin have an in-house motion capture studio, whereby using infrared cameras they can digitize any movement. This is particularly useful in their Actua Sports series, as it gives lifelike movement to the players. Once the graphics are completed, they're incorporated into the game engine, and the programming continues. At the top of Gremlin's offices, one of the last important elements is added to the game, the sound effects. Games with speech are also redubbed into a variety of languages. Once this is done, all that remains is to record the music, which is written and played in-house and then added to the graphics and sound effects. And so the program is finally finished, but it's not quite ready to hit the shelves. The game is now given to the testers, who'll play it all the way through looking for bugs and glitches, or simply anything they don't like. These problems are then reported to the programmers, who'll try and fix them. For us players, this is possibly the most important part of game production, as no one wants to buy a faulty game.
In April 2020, I got in contact with the artist Martin Rotherham, and of course I had plenty of questions about his time on Hogs. He said, and I quote,
"I did work on Hogs about a million years ago. It was my very first job in the industry, and I am afraid I did very little to contribute as I was right at the start of my learning curve. It was all so long ago that I have little memory of it, other than I know I enjoyed the experience. Met some fab folk. None of who I know now, as I moved on, and I learned a lot. Enough to get me my next job at Rage, then Magenta Software. Been self-employed since, none of this would have happened without Hogs."
Gremlin certainly seemed the place to be for up-and-coming players in the games industry. Joining the star-studded cast on the Hogs development team was studio manager Carl Cavers, executive producer Mark Glossop, and creative manager Phil Fellon. Phil Wilson headed up the additional designer spot, while additional programmers Paul Tapper, Paul Hilly, Philip Rankin, Graham Stone, James Long, Simon Nicholas, and Andrew Fox were brought in to boost up the squad, including physics programmers Ian Badko and Ben Wilson. Darren Mills took up the lead FMV artist position alongside his team made up of Richard Simmons, Gavin Whelan, and John Hackleton. Matthew White also took up the producer slot, with Sarah Bennett being in charge of localization, Robert Lunt as the QA supervisor, and Nick Herring as lead QA tester. As we heard from Martin Rotherham, not everyone on the team was an industry veteran, and not everyone was going to remain at Gremlin for the entirety of the game's development. So the 12th of August 1998 rolls around, and the team have just produced their first prototype. As expected, Gremlin followed these same techniques that had brought them success in the Actua Sports series. For this prototype of Hogs, they used the same engine as Actua Golf, while utilizing their in-house motion capture studio. Sadly though, things didn't work out quite so well.
So to give you a bit of background, I mean, we developed the game to a certain stage, but at that point, the game wasn't looking good. The pigs looked quite scary. Nobody liked them. The gameplay wasn't there at all. And it was all a bit hideous. I mean, we've got a bit of a clip of that. This is the front end as it was then. That was written, so the front end programmer on Hogs of War went on to be the programmer of Worms 3D. So they poached him after that project, and he went on and worked on Worms as well. But once we get into the game, you'll kind of see it was really quite clunky. So the pigs are quite sort of human-like and tall. And they were using motion capture data to try and kind of shoehorn in. See lots of tearing problems in the user interface here. It was pretty slow and hideous. So, I mean, at this point, the game really could not have existed. It was looked at by management, and they said, you know, this isn't working, guys. Perhaps we should think about canning the project and doing something else. But the team really believed in the idea, and we said, well, no, you know, give us a little bit longer. We'll strip it down, and we remade the game as what we called Cubes of War. So we took all the graphics out and, you know, replaced pigs with boxes and had boxes shooting other boxes across the level. And that gameplay prototype actually demonstrated that the game was fun to play. And we had a separate prototype where we sort of made the pigs look cuter as well. It was only when we got those two things together that management said, yeah, okay, this has got some legs.
Little more than a month later, in September of that same year, the team updated their prototype for ECTS, the European Computer Trade Show, which was being held in London. However, this would eventually become the turning point for the project. As time rolled over into 1999, Gremlin Interactive's financial situation began to take a turn for the worst. Barely 2 years prior, Gremlin was looking to float the company on the London Stock Exchange. To put it simply, floating a company involves selling a percentage of your company in the form of shares to stock market investors. However, by late 1998, Gremlin's share price had fallen rapidly following a profit warning. This warning was essentially a declaration by Gremlin to their investors on the stock exchange that the profit of the company in the coming financial quarter would be a significant decline when compared to that of the same quarter of the previous year. Their previous acquisition of Scottish studio DMA was intended to boost the company's overall value. However, their estimates fell well short of the original proposed mark of £45 million. The company had also failed to raise its £12 million target, which ultimately left it in a very vulnerable position. So, in January 1999, Gremlin announced it was in takeover talks with the French-based publisher Infogrames. The two companies had already enjoyed a successful relationship together, having previously agreed distribution rights for each other's products. At the time, Infogrames had propelled themselves into the top 10 of the world's best interactive game publishers. Its revenue for the last financial year alone were the equivalent to $244.6 million. And in March 1999, Infogrames completed their takeover of Gremlin Interactive for $40 million, which equates to about £29 million today. The takeover saw an immediate rebranding of Gremlin, renaming them to Infogrames Sheffield House. With the takeover complete, the CEO of Gremlin Interactive, Ian Stewart, initially intended to remain at the helm of Infogrames Sheffield House. However, not long after the sale to Infogrames, Ian suffered a heart attack while on a skiing holiday abroad with his daughter. After a successful quadruple heart bypass operation, Ian would return to England, but his heart attack had changed everything for him personally. The plan was for Ian to still run Sheffield House from day to day, but after the accident he felt otherwise and had to step away from the company. With their main man no longer in the picture, morale was seemingly low for the remaining Gremlin staff. The Hogs development team were caught right in the middle of things, however the recent takeover had actually worked in their favour.
But it was about that time that we were being taken over by Infogrames too. So this whole process, the legal process of being taken over by another company takes ages. So it was actually a great benefit to the project because we kept working, we kept making it better and better. And then eventually when our new French masters came and looked at it, They said, hey, this is really good fun. We like this game.
So that timing really helped then.
It really did, yeah. I mean, it wasn't great for Gremlin to be, you know, the flotation on the stock market going wrong and being subject to a hostile takeover. But for Hogs of War, that actually gave us the extra development time to make it something that actually ultimately succeeded.
And I guess when you got it to that level, was it easier to implement stuff like the random generation for levels, which added a lot of life to the game?
Yeah. No, I mean, we got, once people believed in it again, and it was the multiplayer mode, you know, not the single player mode that really got people. We had some executives sort of come from Infograms and play the game, and we could just hear from outside the room they were laughing themselves stupid. And interesting, the guy that came in and looked at it from Infograms is a guy called Sean Millard, who is now the creative director at Sumo Digital in Sheffield. But he really loved the game, and we got backing then to carry on and invest more time. But also, you know, they were willing to invest money in marketing. And, you know, that's how we led on to getting Rick Mail involved.
During the time of the takeover, the team had been hard at work on completely changing the design of Hogs. They'd gone back to the drawing board, focusing more on refining gameplay first before eventually settling on the visuals. The game would go through several iterations in 1999, as this would prove to be the time where a lot of the gameplay elements, such as maps, physics, weapons, particle effects, and vehicles, would be continuously tried and tested. This was perhaps the most vital point in Hogs of War's development, given how so many ideas and assets were being thrown around by the team. Between their first prototype in 1998 and their third in 1999, a space of only 5 months, the development team had created over 70 different maps. The classes and their structure were slowly taking shape, albeit with slightly different weapons and abilities than we know today.
What was your earliest memory of Hogs?
My earliest memory of Hogs? I think it was watching my dad playing the game, laying on the couch. So, for some reason, always when I'm thinking about this, I'm always thinking about Mission 14 battle stations. So it really was... He played it very often, he played it like twice a year. And but always the whole campaign on 2 or 3 days. So every time I come home from school, he was most of the time playing it already. So I just lay myself next to him on the couch. He was playing the game, I was watching him, and it actually... I think I saw him beating it 5 or 6 times till I actually beat it the first time myself, because I wasn't nearly as good as him at that time.
I was probably about 3, maybe 4 years old when I remember going to my cousin's house, because they used to babysit us when we were young like that. But I remember going over there and they were playing the game. I believe they were on Mission 4. See, the silly part is that I can only remember a tiny little bit of this. I only remember a sushi swine grunt walking into the water. That's all I can remember. That's one of my earliest childhood memories of this game. The memory I have after that is when I think it was like the next week or the week after that, me and my brother convinced our parents to go to a video store. It was called Canyon Rental. It doesn't exist anymore. It went out of business years ago. But I remember going there, and we found Hogs of War. And, of course, back then we didn't really buy games, we rented them, so we rented it for a week. I remember playing Graveyard Shift a decent amount, and Ice Flip. And that's really about it for childhood. I did not actually play this game much as a kid.
I used to play it on and off growing up, but my earliest memory was when I was in infant school. My family used to buy me one game per couple of weeks, and I got Hogs of War in a 2-pack with Worms. And I remember picking it up for the first time and thinking, this is a pretty decent game. It wasn't my favourite at the time, but I felt like I sensed serious potential with this game. It wasn't until I played it in my teenage years that I realised this potential, and that's essentially what got me hooked on Hogs of War in the first place. And then this exploration for potential expanded even further when I played it on PC for the first time. Granted, the PlayStation 1 version was the version I grew up with, but once I played both versions and compared the two, that's when the gaming light shone through.
I do not have a lot of memories, not a lot of memories stick with me from when I was a child, for no particular reason. especially when it comes to gaming. But I do remember like that time when I almost made a Hogs of War tournament, which I know it's cliche, considering that's also what I'm doing today. But I remember I had like the poster like all written on a post-it note, and it was like tons of text on a small square, which you couldn't read anything. And also one other thing that I remember is my friend, which is still my neighbor, by the way, which used to make fun of the fact that Mon Pork, which is the equivalent of one, I believe, was my favorite pig. He's the scaredy cat, or scaredy pig, I should say. So basically it made me laugh so much when he said, I can't say the exact words, of course, but he used to say that he was, to put it simply, a person who changes his pants a lot.
I recently got in touch with one of the original Hogs physics programmers, Ian Badko, to discuss his memories on the project.
So I was running the R&D team at Gremlin, and we unwisely volunteered to create a physics engine for the game. Which was a bit of a nightmare given the need to run on the original PlayStation, which had no floating point capability. I can't quite remember, but I think we may have volunteered to do that on PC and been caught out when it was needed on PlayStation. Or we may have just massively underestimated how awkward it was going to be. I remember a few things. 1. Spending ages watching a sphere roll around a height-mapped landscape and trying to work out why its energy was conserved nicely when a similar test with a long bar was chronically unstable. 2. Debugging awkward cases where, for example, a pig stepping down off a vehicle fell through the landscape because it turned out that under certain conditions the step down was slightly up. 3. Playtesting close to completion, which was pretty great actually, because we'd not known earlier in the project whether it was actually going to be fun. There must have been things we wanted to do which we couldn't. I remember early in the project we thought that properly simulated vehicles would be easy, because we'd have to have the physics working that well already. That went out the window quite early. I think by later development the physics aspects were long locked down, however, and it was more in areas like IE that stuff got reluctantly dropped. I remember it was me who had the idea for the shrapnel grenade, that fires a ring of bullets when it explodes.
Honestly, it was probably about in 2009, maybe 2010. But I remember we were sitting there watching YouTube, and out of nowhere my brother just says, "What was that one game, where you shot pigs?" And for some reason, I remember it perfectly. I can remember the name of it. I suddenly yelled out, "Hogs of War." And we searched it up, and there was a couple videos. Watched them for a good while, and slowly but surely I kept watching them, but I realized there was no full playthroughs of the game. I could never find a full playthrough of the game. So the thing that got me kind of hooked was seeing someone beat the whole game.
I don't know, it just had something, it was funny, it was a little bit of strategy, you could play it together, like when I was a bit older I had some friends come over and we played it together on one couch, we just hand over the controller to each other and played the game and just had fun. It was the pigs, it was funny to watch them swim, to hear the voices, to hear the speeches, the little speeches they have.
After their final prototype in February 1999, it was finally time for the team to take the best of what they had created so far and begin work on the first alpha build. In the space of the next 9 months, the game would go from alpha through to beta and finally release. It would be a frantic race to the finish. The alpha saw an updated UI structure, weapons that actually worked, basic physics and vehicle implementation and movement, character animation improvements, new particle effects, alongside an extensive overhaul of each class and difficulty balancing. The alpha version of Hogs set the minimum standard of what the game had to offer, and on the 12th of May 1999, Hogs of War was showcased at E3. The project still had a lengthy way to go, and it was roughly about this time that full-time QA testing began to take place. Initially, Hogs of War was only intended to be a PlayStation game, but all that was to change later on down the line. In August 2020, I proceeded to contact Robert Lunt, the QA supervisor and test manager who worked on Hogs. Once again, I had a whole bunch of questions to ask, and thankfully, he was happy to oblige.
At that time I was the Q&A test supervisor and test manager, and the department was going through a lot of change. Previously the teams were split in two, console and PC. The PC teams kinda looked down on the console teams for some reason. I think it was because they had to be self-sufficient, that is, they were testers and tech support, so any problems with the PC, and there were a lot we had to fix ourselves, and change out sound video cards for compatibility testing. All a console tester had to do was switch it on or off or put it on its side if it was old. Thing was though, it was becoming clear with the Dreamcast out, PS2 nearly out and the Xbox on its way. Infogrames was shifting efforts to console, so we were trying to mix teams up a little and group efforts to titles rather than hardware. Hogs of War was an odd one. I don't think Infogrames liked as it didn't meet their image or something. They inherited from the buyout of Gremlin, so there was no real push for it. It was meant for the PlayStation only, to compete with Worms and Lemmings, so it was kinda kicked around a bit. Then it was picked up by a publishing producer, so we had to dust it off and get it released as soon as possible. Testing, we had two lead testers, one for the console and one for PC. The game was using the actual Golf engine, so whatever issues that had, Hogs inherited them. It wasn't great, not many of the testers liked it. This tended to happen with the internally created games, as the development teams would ask for it to be put into test early for feedback. But once in, they would stay and be expected to be worked on whether it was ready or not. It could be argued that it was early agile, but only if you've had a few. One title was in test for 3 years. Soul Brinner, or as it was nicknamed, Soul Destroyer. Most titles were in test for about 8 months. I got the feeling that producers were interested in how many hours test had worked on it and the volume of bugs rather than the real quality of the product. Slowly though it came good. I think it helped having Rick Mayall doing the pig's voices and CGI cutscenes. There were glitches everywhere with it, as I said it was using a Golf engine, the PC network version never worked. But that might have something to do with one of the developers' PC blue screening partway through a build. He had to go to a backup 24 hours before it was due to go to Goldmaster and publishing. I think the version that was released was 3 versions old, but the ini.file and readme file were updated so no one could tell. The PlayStation version did have one major issue, a 100% repeatable bug which we tried to blag our way through with Sony and the publishing producer. But because Sony found it and we didn't, they wanted it fixed. Basically, if you dropped out of a Zeppelin and paused the game just before the Parapig's chute opens, the game would freeze. We fixed it and resubbed it, they were that picky back then, but there was no update feature back then, so it had to be right. Another issue, well feature, was the Italian version. We'd hire European students to help with localization from Sheffield University. We were very lucky in that we had an Italian in our team, and he checked the Italian version. Localization versions of games would be tested last, generally about 2 weeks before submission. Late one day Steve came over to my desk and said, "Rob, we can't release this." "Why?" "The pigs are telling each other to fuck off in Italian." "Oh, bollocks." We had a chat with the localization manager, she made some calls but apparently it was okay. As the Italian comedian we hired was renowned for talking in this way, so it was fine to have on a kid's game. The lead testers would also create the test plans. We call them test plans, but they were in fact the test cases for the game. They were created in Word and printed out so a tester could fill them in. They were then collected in by the lead tester, who would then sign off each area that was worked on and kept a tally in order to then discuss it with the PM and lead developer. Our playthrough testers were very quick at completing games. If a game had, say, 7 hours gameplay to it, they'd complete it in 4 or 5 hours. We'd send them to either Sony or Microsoft to support the submission process, and to give us a heads up if we needed to do a resubmission. Our functionality testers didn't play through the game, but made sure the overall game functionally worked. They would also cover the TCRs for Sony. We had no dedicated network testers, we just used the same team. Network gaming wasn't as big as it is now. Broadband wasn't really out yet, so networking was PTP or a serial cable. The main tools we used back then were Microsoft Word, Excel and Grimbugs. Grimbugs was our bespoke network bug tracking tool. It was great when it worked.
So we finally have the answer to the age-old question as to why the PC version is so broken. The AI don't move, the networking is non-functional, the audio is all over the place, and that blue screen is the answer. My understanding at the time was that there was some kind of missing source code which ended up messing things up, and as Robert continues to say, that is probably the cause.
Yeah, the blue screen of death caused that problem for sure. It's coming back to me. We released a patch for the January edition of PC Gamer. Maybe the Steam version didn't get that update and only uses the released version. Still better than hiding it in the desert.
The thing you have to remember though is that deadlines are a tricky thing, and something had to be sent to the publisher, otherwise they'd be left empty-handed. It is a shame though, considering how the PC version could have pushed things a bit more in relation to networking. Even if it was functional on a very basic level, something could have been done within the community to either improve that, to have multiplayer working a bit better, and for us not to have to use things like Parsec to play on the PlayStation version, on the PC, on an emulator. It just gets very confusing.
And also, I think the Steam release, although we all know the game wasn't too good on the Steam version, but it has some flaws, but I think that helped a lot as well to keep it in the mind of people, or to help them remember, oh, there was a Steam version, and it didn't cost a lot, so a lot probably bought it, and it's just, Hogs is still around, and that's an important thing.
It's probably a lot of different factors. One thing I would say for sure is the fact that I had never played a game with turn-based combat. Not even RPGs at that point. I mean, I was very little. So it was such a weird concept for me. And then the fact that you were playing with pigs. So, mind blown. And then the stereotypes, of course. The funny voices. But I wouldn't say that was the main thing that got me hooked on the game. I kept replaying and replaying the campaign. So, I would say the gameplay was definitely number one factor that got me hooked in Hogs of War.
During the game's transition from alpha to release, the project would produce 4 different demos, which subsequently would wind up on the Euro demo discs number 60, 85, 91, and 102. Hogs was taking shape into the game we know it to be today, but it still was missing that one key ingredient. Throughout the alpha stage of development, the team had been using in-house members to produce the voices for the pigs, and that could be heard in the earlier demos.
Hey ho! Nice little brother.
How's he doing?
Whatever, sir.
Chicken!
Tally-ho!
Does that mean me? Chicken! Fighter! Right up the Harris! For clown and country!
One for you, stinker!
In order to boost the product up just that little bit more, the team needed an extra spark that could bring their creations to life. Enter Rick Mail and Mark Silk.
Yeah, very good. Such as the Mark 13 multi-wing fighter. Oh, what a secret. It needs to, perhaps you need to nail the fact that it's a little more obvious. Oh, what a secret. Top scientists have just completed it. Well, you remember it. I ain't got a pen. Okay, let's shoot, yeah? It may well be an innocent and topical chat between comrades, but no. Resist the temptation of disclosure. Loose lips sink ships. It may well be an innocent and topical chat between comrades, but no, resist the temptation. Oh, fuck this line. It may well be an innocent and topical chat between comrades, but no, resist the temptation of disclosure. Loose lips sink ships. Mm-hmm. But no, resist the temptation of disclosure. Loose lips cost ship. It may well be an innocent and topical chat between comrades, but no, resist the temptation of disclosure. Loose lips sink ships. The enemy is everywhere. The entire war effort depends on keeping secrets under wraps, such as the Mark 13 multi-winged fighter. Oh, great secret. Top scientists have just completed this state-of-the-art prototype that could determine the outcome of the air war. Look at it. Oh, the Germans will never find out. Thanks to you. I'm going to underline the gag. Let me try that. Lost two. We're all right up to sink ships, aren't we? By now? Yeah? We are?
The enemy is everywhere. The entire war effort depends on keeping secrets under wraps. Such as the Mark 13 multi-winged fighter. Oh, top secret. And what a secret. Oh, look, top scientists have just completed this state-of-the-art prototype that could determine the outcome of the air war. But the Germans will never find out so long as you keep this a secret. Good work, lads. Good work. Don't tell the wife.
Hey, currently available. They're just talking about some of my delivery of the lines. This is how it works. If you're a young person... think you're becoming an actor? Don't become an actor, because it's my work. I've got friends, some of them are tall, and many of them are ex-drug dealers. If you think of becoming an actor and you and I are up for the same audition, you are not going to get the part, but that's the top of your problems. You may not be able to walk again, you may be blinded, anything could happen. Not just to you, to your loved ones as well. Don't become an actor. It's my work. Okay, someone's here.
So we had a bit of discussion. Once Infograms were invested in the idea again, they said, well, look, we're really interested in getting some comedians involved. They had some French comedians, whose name I forget, unfortunately. But they wanted them to do the voiceovers for the games. And they said, well, you know, was there an English comedian that we could use for the UK version? I actually wanted Stephen Fry, so that was my first bid, but the marketing people sort of, you know, put out messages and they came up with Rick Mayall. So I mean, it was fantastic. You know, we were all in the same, you know, Blackadder world, so that was great. No, I mean, he was incredible for the game, and you know, that is often what people sort of remember so fondly about the game, is Rick Mayall's quips. But I mean, a lot of voiceover was done by Mark Silk as well, so a professional voiceover artist. But no, it was brilliant to have him in there. I was very disappointed that I didn't actually get to meet him, though. I had a seat in the car to go to the recording where he was doing it, but unfortunately I was trumped by a marketing executive. Perhaps it's because I voted for Stephen Fry, I don't know.
Well, what about, you know, from the people you did work with, who did work with Rick, how did they describe working with him on the go?
I mean, they said it was brilliant. You know, I was trying to close my ears. But no, I mean, Aid Carlos was, the designer was a you know, a big character himself. So I think they probably had a quite, you know, a complete riot when they got together.
I think we can all agree that the introduction of Rick Mail was a huge boost, not just for Hogs of War as a video game, but for the team developing it as well. Rick had already developed a huge cult following here in the UK, and compare that to Mark Silk, whose career was only just getting started, there was a huge comparison made between both actors. And it was also not long after Rick Mail had been involved in a quad bike accident, so a lot of people in the UK, including the media, were very interested to see if he still had it in him to produce the comedy that he'd done on the likes of Blackadder and Bottom and the Young Ones back in the 80s. In fact, to this day, Mark Silk still is a little bit overshadowed by the likes of Rick Mail when it comes to Hogs of War. The focus I found from listening to a lot of people's thoughts on the game, and indeed new and old players who are getting back into the game, their focus, especially if they are from the UK, is Rick Mail. It is always Rick Mail. As anticipated though, Rick Mail knocked it out the park, although ironically Mark Silk did more of the voices in Hogs of War than Rick Mail, but the comparison between the two is not required because both actors are just awesome at what they do. And of course, Mark Silk went on to produce many voices in different cartoons, the likes of Johnny Bravo and Scooby-Doo and a whole bunch of other ones that you've probably heard before but never realized it was actually Mark Silk.
Well, definitely that it had a German translation helped a lot. Of course, here in Austria we speak German as well. And yeah, it just had the translation. I know a lot of English natives, or a lot of people in the UK, are big fan of Rick Mail and who speak the voices together with Mark Silk. But I guess I don't even know who did the German translation, but it was very well done. Definitely had the humor, the funny quotes and speeches were in the game. So it wasn't too unpopular, I guess. So we have our own translation of the game, it's called Frontliner here, and I know, and yeah, of course, and my friendship, most of them played the game with me, but I also met a couple of other people who know the game, even without me, or not from me, and I think it wasn't that unpopular in German, so definitely had its moments as well.
Well, as you may or may not know, I'm one of the few Americans in this Hogs of War server, so admittedly, the game was not very popular where I came from. Besides me and my cousins at the time, I wouldn't be surprised if anyone else hadn't heard about it. I think the reason that it didn't do so well here in America was a lot of the British stereotypes, and Americans weren't very occupied with turn-based games at the time. Worms was kind of popular at the time, but most time it was, at that time it was platformers that was doing really well. So Hogs of War kind of just fell into the hole, never to be seen again, unfortunately.
A lot of people actually know it, so I'm thinking many more people than we know, or we think, actually played it. And in Italy, it was such this weird thing, which I've never seen before, by the way, of the fact that the localization had this crazy idea of just ditching one team and replacing it with an Italian team. Like, they ditched Sushi's Wine and replaced it with Suini Bellici. And of course, I think that the localization is the main factor that got the game to being quote-unquote popular, because it uses the same principle, basically, and as the original version. Like, the Tommy Strotters, for you British people, they have their accents represented by one beat each. And the Italian team has the same thing. There's the guy from Rome, the guy from Sardinia, from Sicily, and so on. So it was just so fun to just listen to the voices and laugh at them. But yeah, the obvious choice would be to say that the game has gotten popular because of the voices. But I have to state the facts here, and I have to say that the main thing was that genius idea from that localization guy who thought of putting an Italian team that was not there before in the original version. Which again, in 20 years that I've been playing games, it's something I never heard of before.
With the voice work in the bag, the project was quickly approaching its final descent to completion. A couple of months before the turn of the new millennium, on the 26th of April 2000, the game would reach the beta stage of development. At this point, near enough everything about the game was ready to go. All the major balance changes, map designs, and story were finished. The gameplay just needed some final bug testing and polish to get it over the finish line. Alpha testing had whittled the single player campaign down to 25 missions, with the same amount of maps given to the multiplayer mode. The class structure from the alpha to beta was changed as well, with the likes of the architect within the engineer class being removed entirely, replaced by the saboteur, who originally was a part of the espionage class. Certain class abilities were removed as well, including the infamous build ability possessed by the medical and engineer class that allowed for the construction of walls, shelters, pillboxes, medical and mash tents. All health pools were adjusted as well, the physics were locked down, and vehicle systems were implemented. Then, on the 8th of June 2000, Hogs of War was finally released on PlayStation 1 in Europe, followed shortly after by a North American release on the 29th of September, and later for Windows on PC in November of the same year. Despite a heavy marketing campaign which included TV advertisements, washroom posters, demo trailers, and a variety of printed ads, the game overall was met with moderate reviews from the gaming world.
The troops are massing, training, becoming lean, mean, fighting machines. Ooh, scaring the enemy. Say goodbye to your sweethearts. It's time for war! Time to butcher the enemy. Hack them until the last hog is had. Hogs of War from Infograms. Fight like a pig.
The timing of the game's release didn't help either, as it began to be overshadowed by much bigger releases, including the likes of Tony Hawk Pro Skater 2, Spider-Man, Persona 2, and Final Fantasy IX. There was, of course, the large comparison with Worms from game journalists, along with some pretty average scores. Despite large popularity for the likes of Rick Mail and success in European countries like Russia, Italy, France, and Germany, the game just wasn't selling over in the US market. At the time, Infograms had shifted the majority of their management team over to their division in the United States, so the focus for them was moving away from Europe. This change in focus would eventually be the primary factor for the failed attempted sequel for Hogs of War 2.
I definitely knew there was going to be a second or a sequel to the game at some point, and when I read about it, I was all excited, but then I realized it was like cancelled 5 years ago, so I was a bit bummed about that, but before that, I didn't know before I joined the Discord or before, like, there was attention given to the game again, I didn't know a lot.
I mean, was there a plan to do, like, a sequel at that stage then, or any talks of it while I'm there?
Yeah, I mean, there have been a number of planned sequels over the years. So we were going to make Hogs of War 2 almost straight afterwards. But surprise, surprise, they found that the game didn't really sell well in America. Basically, they said, well, you know, it's a very quirky British sense of humor. Americans didn't really get it. And at that point, you know, that was a really huge chunk of the console market. So Infograms didn't feel they could invest in a game that was only going to sell in Europe, even if it, you know, sold really well in Europe. So the sequel that was planned by Infograms was called Hogs of War 2, The Buns of Navarone. And I have the design document. I mean, it was going to be much more character-based. So the idea was it was kind of a bit like Dirty Dozen. So these were kind of pigs that were taken out of prison to perform this kind of death-defying mission. And I think, you know, the designers were really wrestling with this that in the original game you had this sort of leveling up mentality of the pigs. You could promote them through the ranks. You could name them as a grunt and see them go up through the ranks and give them different abilities by taking them in different directions. What the designers wanted with the sequel was more that you'd have a real personality in each character. Thus, the upgrades wouldn't have changed them quite as much, but it allowed them to sort of put kind of characters that would have worked on PlayStation 2, put that much more detail into them. And I think it would have been really interesting to have seen.
That's definitely a huge part of it is nostalgia. So you liked it as a kid and you have nothing to do this afternoon thinking of it and think about the game and you play it and you love it again. And of course, a huge part of it is nostalgia, but I think the other thing why people play today is because it's a great game. And also with the events we do in the Discord and just being able to play it online together now and just the speedrunning scene. And just if you play casually for yourself, the mods, of course, they keep encouraging the people to play.
Hogs of War 2, The Buns of Navarone, was to be set during World War 2. It intended to follow the story of a squad of misfit prisoners who would be used to do the bidding of their country in order to earn their freedom, similar to the likes of the 1967 movie The Dirty Dozen. The sequel's title was based on the 1961 movie The Guns of Navarone. Initially, it was intended to be released on PlayStation 2, with possible further releases on Xbox, PC, and handheld devices of the time, such as the upcoming Nintendo DS. A rough concept for Hogs of War 2 was drawn up 1 year after the release of the original in 2001, but it would take another 7 years for any further information to come to light. In 2003, Infogrames decided to shut down the Sheffield House Development Studio before rebranding themselves under the Atari name after their acquisition of Hasbro's Interactive. Infogrames would later meet the same fate as Gremlin, as the Rapid Company expansion ended up swallowing itself. In April 2007, Infogrames chairman Bruno Bonnell left the company after 24 years. After his resignation, Infogrames began to sell off some of their intellectual property in order to avoid bankruptcy. The company proceeded to lay off 20% of their own staff, but in the end this couldn't stem the tide of their losses. In the fiscal year of 2006 and 2007, Atari posted a net loss of $70 million. Then in April 2008, Infogrames submitted an offer to Atari for them to buy out its remaining public shares. Atari would accept the offer, and in the same month both companies would merge. During that same year, Infogrames announced online that Hogs of War 2 was indeed in development. However, news of its production quickly went quiet after the company once again produced huge financial losses for the 2008 fiscal year. With $72 million in net losses and an American market that wasn't particularly interested in a Hogs sequel, the project was eventually dropped. All of the original Hogs team had actually moved on way back in 2003, some even earlier. So where is everyone now? Well, four former Gremlins who worked during the Infogrames period, Carl Cavers, Paul Porter, Darren Mills, and James North Hearn, would create their own studio, Sumo Digital, in 2003. Hogs senior designer Aid Carlos would leave Infogrames in 2002, moving on to work for companies including Elexia, Eidos, and Rockstar. He currently resides in San Francisco as a freelance game designer. Programmer Paul Tapper would later go on to work on the later Worms games for Team 17 in 2003, while also co-founding his own company, Nugent Audio, in 2004. Phil Wilson left the Hogs project in 1999, but went on to work for Rage Games, Yeti Studios, and Blitz Games. Phil Rankin, Simon Nicholas, and Ian Badko would all eventually join their former colleagues at Sumo Digital, while producer Matt White and lead programmer Andrew Fox would go their separate ways, working for big companies like Zoo Digital, Autodesk, and Codemasters. Additional senior programmer James Long would continue to work at Infogrames until 2003, before also moving on to the likes of Zoo Digital, Zushi Games, Sumo, Team 17, and Codemasters. Paul Hilly would continue working under Infogrames and then Atari as a senior software engineer until 2006, before moving on to the likes of Paradigm, Activision, and Insomniac Games. The art department saw Ricky Martin move on to EA in the UK and Canada, Gavin Whelan to Funcom in Oslo, and Richard Simmons onto Sumo Digital, who later shifted into freelance art, photography, and videography. The lead console programmer, Jacob Hapgood, also left Infogrames in 2003, having remained during the Atari transition as the technical lead on the game Micro Machines, which released on PS2 and Xbox. From there, he would step into the world of education, working at the University of Nottingham for 3 years until 2006, where he then moved to join his former colleagues at Sumo Digital as project manager. He would remain there for another 3 years until 2009, where once again he stepped back into education as a senior lecturer in game development at Sheffield Hallam University. Over the next 10 years, Jacob would also work as the studio director of Steel Minions, Sheffield Hallam's student game studio. Here he would integrate his teaching alongside the studio's activities, to the point where the studio and its students were releasing multiple titles for the PS4 and PSVR store.
I originally worked in the games industry. I used to work for a company called Gremlin Graphics in Sheffield, and I spent most of my career making PlayStation games. So the fantastic thing about teaching here at Sheffield Hallam is that we have a great relationship with Sony Computer Entertainment. We have access to PlayStation development kits, and we take those games to market as well. So we have student projects where students have created games that have gone on to be published on the PlayStation Store. Sheffield Hallam has a fantastic relationship with the games industry. We've had students here that have gone on to work on really big titles like Little Big Planet or Crackdown. And our relationship with companies like Sumo Digital locally means that students have got that kind of direct route and contact with the games industry. At Sheffield Hallam, we've got the world's largest PlayStation teaching facilities. So we have PlayStation 4 development kits, we have PlayStation Vita development kits, we've got PlayStation VR headsets, and we've done projects and published projects with all of those. So that's really quite exciting. So my research background is in educational game development. I did a PhD in game-based learning. So we run a number of research projects looking at how you integrate learning content into games.
It would be here at Sheffield Hallam, where almost 20 years after Hogs of War's initial release, the catalyst for a remaster would be set in motion. With Jacob Hapgood teaching at the university, and former Gremlin CEO Ian Stewart remaining in Sheffield with his new company UrbanScan, the pieces were beginning to fall into place. A student by the name of Luke Melville, who had been taught by Hapgood, was attempting an ambitious thesis. He called it Hogs of War, a case study for remastering classic PlayStation games.
Hello, my name is Luke Melville, and this is the demo video for my independent project deliverable, a gameplay feasibility prototype for Hogs of War. In the prototype, the keys W, S, A, and D can be used to move the camera around the scene. If held in combination with the shift key, it moves the camera faster. Space and control also dictate the height of the camera in Y direction. To play back the game, you can press E. This will start the game's code. The speed in which the game plays back can be controlled with Z and X, which slows down and speeds up playback speed of the game. Game playback can be paused by pressing E again. If we press T, this makes the camera track an object that we press with any of the number keys to focus on each one of the pigs. And this is toggled, so if we have tracking mode on, no matter where the camera moves, it will still look at the pig. A pig is outlined by a pink cube and or a green cube, depending if that pig is in control. And they have a pyramid appended to on top of the pig to dictate if each pig is friendly to the pig that is in control, it'll be blue, and if they're enemies, it'll be red. H toggles drawing of hidden objects, so this could be all objects that aren't supposed to be rendered within the original game's code but do still exist within the world. For instance, the brown object hovering around the pig in control is the camera.
After the success of his thesis, Luke and Jacob approached Ian Stewart with the idea of creating a remaster for Hogs. After stepping down as CEO of Sheffield House back in 1999, Ian would later reacquire some of Gremlin's older titles under his new company Urban Scan, including the likes of Premier Manager Series, Founders World, and thankfully enough, Hogs of War.
When I left the industry and Infogrames was closing down, I knew I was going to academia. I knew I was going to be doing teaching. So I got their permission at that point to take the resources from the games I've worked on with me for my teaching. So I've been using Hogs of War in my teaching for the best part of a decade. But bizarrely, it's not been until this year that a group of students have actually completely taken the game apart. So they've managed to get the levels, the level format working, and they've actually got it running on a PlayStation 4. So they've got the original PlayStation 1 code all running on the PlayStation 4. They're starting to write a renderer working for it. And if they can get the kind of pig animation working, then you know we would actually have a version that would work. At the moment, it's just a student project, but you know it's looking very promising.
Along with a team of other students, Luke proceeded to start development of the remaster, which we all know now to be called Hogs of War Reheated. The project originally started with a much larger team. However, this has been lowered after students proceeded to graduate and progress into other jobs in the industry. That and the project itself has shifted from being a student project into something official under Urban Scan. Reheated has been in development since 2018. At current writing, it does not have a release date and is still on course for release for the PlayStation 4.
So first of all, I laugh that there's a remake or remaster. I always confuse those two, so it's one of those two, I know. But I'm so excited they're going to do it. So there were a lot of fan-made projects going on for Hogs of War over the years. But this is a bit different since it's not fan-made anymore and it's a real thing. And there's definitely pressure on them, so pressure from the fans. But I think that's for every new game, if you remake it, there's a pressure, of course, to catch the charm, the what made the old game so special, to have the feeling when you play the new game as well.
Honestly, I am really excited for Reheated. It's an awesome idea to see this game come back so much, considering it was pretty much forgotten about for so long. But you need to keep in mind that, as a few people have forgotten in the community, that it takes a long time to develop a remaster, especially from the Hogs of War. As you have been quoted saying, the code is spaghetti. And I think that's a good way of putting it, that the game was put together piece by piece and very hard to recreate.
One thing to make it successful, I think, currently I guess it's planned to be PS4 exclusive, and that might be a thing that's for new games, like I'm thinking of Spyro or the Crash Bandicoot games that also were on the PS1. They all are available on the PC now, and especially for a game like Hogs, you have to have multiplayer and online multiplayer. It's basically made for such a feature, and I think if it has an online multiplayer and is available on the PC, it will be a huge success. I'm not saying it won't be a success if it's PS4 exclusive, but I guess if it really should be having a huge impact, it has to have the two features.
Hogs of War Reheated is a huge step in the right direction for bringing back the flair of the original game. I'd say because of the current situation we are in, things have had to change their course a little bit, and in this instance, Reheated has been pushed back drastically. Nevertheless, I can't wait to see new footage for Reheated, but as always, patience is a virtue, and we need to be patient with the developers of Reheated. I do believe there is pressure on the team, but we shouldn't need to pressure a game to be released, especially for a game like Hogs of War Reheated. I think so long as we give our honest input and feedback, then we can make the remastering of Hogs of War a game that we can all enjoy.
Perhaps one of the biggest things I've noticed since being involved with Reheated is the amount of pressure the team are under. Not really from upper management, but more so from the community. I think the one thing we have to remember about the Hogs of War community is that, in a way, we are ready for things to fail or to not come to fruition. And that's just because of the sequel. That pressure to make something, for something to be created that continues the franchise on, is always going to be tough for the developers and the people making it. And we've seen it as well in community projects as well, where fans of the game are ready to invest their money into something, and even those have been snatched away as well. I remember back in the day hearing about the sequel, bearing in mind that I was, you know, barely into my early teens. I was new to the internet as well, so I only heard rumors, but knowing that there was going to be something, and for that something to then be ripped away from us, and to hear nothing back from Infograms, to hear radio silence, it was difficult to take. So the fans of Hogs all over the world have always wanted something, and there'll be intense scrutiny on every single detail. Does it feel like the old game? Does it contain the old mechanics, the old voices, and not just in the English version, but in all localization versions, in Russian, in French, in Spanish, in German? Everything has to be spot on, and it's a very difficult task to maintain. It was back in 2017-18 that my own thoughts shifted to making consistent Hogs of War content here on YouTube. I saw an opportunity to build something that hadn't been done before, and it wasn't until 2018 that I joined a Discord server originally created for Hogs of War speedrunning. The server quickly became my base of operations for all things Hogs, and I wanted it to become something more, something bigger, as time went on. Since that day in 2018, the Hogs community Discord has grown to almost 1,000 members. In fact, by the time this documentary is out, I imagine we'll have surpassed that milestone. It's allowed for discussions to be had with original and new developers, including the likes of Jacob Havgood, Luke Melville, and Stone Sword Games, who within the same time frame created both a card game and a miniatures game for Hogs of War. With each new member, the Discord has expanded every area of conversation, reheated the card game, miniatures game, modding, speedrunning, competitive events, animation, music, voiceover work, and so much more. It's shown that not only is there still a fandom for Hogs, but there is a wanting for more. There always has been. After 20 years since the original game was launched, the Hogs of War community has always remained.
Ever since I tried to Discord 3 years ago, I'm really trying to do my best to keep the game alive, to create unique and special moments for the community, and just do my best to have that people have fun with the game, to still have fun with the game, and also giving feedback to the developers of the new game to get the best new game we can get. And I don't know, just a big thank you to all Hogs of War fans that are still out there today. Without so many fans, I guess it wouldn't be made all. Of course, thanks for Stone Sword Game for making the card game and the miniature game. I'm looking forward to get the miniature game soon and play this. So, did a great job, and it's good to see Hogs still alive.
Honestly, I really hope the community can keep going, even after We Heated comes out. I hope we can continue to do stuff like rank up the league, Grand Prix, and maybe create some more stuff along the way here. And just hopefully what we have gained through this Discord for Hogs and just the friendships as well. Hopefully everything just keeps going and just gets better and better.
This server is a big reason why people still play Hogs of War. I mean, we have done ridiculous things with the game. We modded it. We've created a competitive stance for it, which is to this day still ridiculous. To play a competitive game about pigs shooting at each other, saying funny memes. Basically, that's what it is.
We as a collective community have shown that this game is a true masterpiece of the times, and I hope that the younger generation will pick up this game and play it for themselves, and, you know, experience what we have experienced.
I even built a small sub-community with the Italian team, which we play together Hogs of War every now and then, and we play other games, which is crazy. I never had a crew, a gaming crew, before in my life, because I didn't have any friends who were interested in video games. I had other friends, of course. I was not alone, don't worry. I just never had any kind of friend who was interested in video games as I was. But now I have, and it's all thanks to these pigs shooting each other.
Hogs of War was, for me, and I'm sure for many other kids growing up in the late 90s and early 2000s, their very first introduction into the world of gaming. It may sound strange, but this game heavily influenced my own career choices. It gave me a passion for video games and helped push me towards the industry. When I finished school back in 2012, I had no clue where I wanted to go in life. Video games eventually became my fallback, as I initially enrolled on a games art course where I quickly realized my skills in the modeling department were quite awful. After switching courses, I eventually graduated in 3D computer animation, during which time I managed to land a QA job at Sega, where I have been ever since. At one point or another, Hogs of War has always been there for me. It has been a passion I have carried with me since I was 5 years old. Breaking down and understanding Hogs has enhanced my understanding as a QA tester, it's provided content and inspiration for my animations, and set a huge example for me in the world of voice acting. The latest resurgence of this classic game is likely to continue getting stronger and stronger as time goes forward. 20 years may have passed, but players are still fond of this bacon-filled turn-based shooter. Like I said at the start of this documentary, Hogs of War was never a revolutionary game. It had a steep learning curve, clunky tank controls, and questionable stereotypes, and in some ways is easily forgotten in the wake of the Worms franchise. But if the last 3 years have proven anything, it's that fans of this game are still out there, they still want to play the game, and they still want this franchise to continue moving forward. I for one hope that Reheated does well and succeeds and is able to expand upon new and existing areas of the original, but I guess we'll have to wait and see if that is able to come true. As time moves on, the fewer people there will be to remember the development of Hogs of War. Perhaps the successes of the past can be taken into the future, carried by a community that still loves this game, and I hope will never go away.
Thank you everybody for being a part of the community. Have a good day. Don't ask why my hand is so close to the cable. That's my awkward setup. What am I doing?
And also...
Hey!
What you doing?
Nothing.
Are you revealing Hogs of War top secret information?
Nope.